Christ Jesus, I want to welcome everyone to Mount Tabor United Methodist Church on this beautiful day as we gather to worship here in our sanctuary. And as we're worshiping online at home, just a reminder, if our internet stream does go down, I'm recording it, and then I will then later put it on in the evening. I just have a few announcements. I just want to remind everyone, because we're trying to push all of our stuff here on Sunday, if our service does go over a few minutes, I do apologize, but I'm trying to get everything in here. So I just say that to let you know I'm aware of the time. But every once in a while, I've got so many things. This is the only time we're gathering right now. So some quick announcements, some wonderful announcements. This coming Wednesday, we're going to have a blood drive. This coming Wednesday, we're having a blood drive Wednesday from 1 to 6. I've got some people who are willing to volunteer and help. That is an extra blood drive. It's not our normally quarterly blood drive. That's for kind of like an extra help in our community right now. I'm going to be overseeing it, because I'm overseeing that there will not be a Wednesday night Bible study on Facebook Live this Wednesday, because I'm going to be here helping out with that, giving Don and Betty a break, and so I want to let you know that. I also want you know, starting this coming Thursday night, I'm going to shift our Friday night community prayer time to Thursday night, starting at 6:30. I have been doing it on Friday night. I'm shifting to Thursday night. And I want to like the reason I'm doing that, so that Friday night will open up so my wife and I can have a date here and there, okay? So I don't think anybody will be upset with that. If you are, then go talk to my wife. But you don't worry about that. So Thursday night will be our community prayer time at 6:30, okay? So we're going to move from Friday. So this coming Wednesday, no Bible study. This Thursday will be our 6:30 prayer time, and then I'll do our next Wednesday Bible study afterwards, starting 2 weeks after that. I want to remind everyone, our nominate committee is going to be gathering today here at 2 o'clock. We are in the process of meeting officers. We're having some shifts, some major shifts happening in our church. Mary Holtmeyer is rotating off our chair of SBRC, and John Renner, who has served faithfully as our finance chair, is also rotating off. He wants to do some other things. So we've opened up some real critical positions, and so the nominate committee is going to be meeting and praying. If you feel led on your heart, one thing I love about Mount Tabor people, they're willing to do stuff. Sometimes they're not willing to let me know what they're willing to do. But be praying about this, because our charge conference is October 25th, and I've got to get information in there. And next year, as we move through all the changes as United Methodist, just we need some key leaders who can help us on our leadership team. So be in prayer about that. I want to also let you know that money has been coming in to our church in memory of Tom Morgan. And what that money has been coming in for is for us to plant a tree here on the grounds in honor of Tom Morgan. And so that is actually moving forward. We'll have more information about that. Monty has been helping me on that, working with Ryan, our trustee chair, to tree and trying to find the right kind of tree. I don't know anything about that will live and survive here on our ground. So we'll let you know, be aware of that. In addition to that, I do have some quick notes that people continue to see from Martha. Here are my thoughts and my prayers. Keep the faith, and we'll get through this test together. Love and prayers, Martha. So we received this week, as you know, our sister Marilyn Embry died last week, and we received a note from a person who is a cousin of her with a donation, and it says, encloses a check in memory to Memorial Marilyn Embry, a dear cousin of mine. She was a beautiful example of a Christian wife, mother, and friend, and will be missed by many. May God richly bless you all out there. And that came from Sonia Fagan. And so we've had a good number of deaths in our small church. And so we are definitely in time of grief. And I want us to continue to remember all those as we move into our prayer time. Are there other announcements or information that I've missed, everybody? Well, good. Well, let's take a deep breath. Let's become aware that we are loved by God as we are. And we're loved enough that God wants to make us even better than we are. So let's come to worship the Lord who loves us as we are, and who also transforms us into the image of Jesus. Oh Lord, may we hear you, may we trust you, and may we obey you. Well, this morning, let us stand and worship. Mike, would you open up the door for some of our children to ring the bell? Thank you. Let us worship the Lord together. Gather for a time of community prayer as we offer our praises and concerns to the Lord. And I just want to start off with a confession. I was standing there and realized I made an inappropriate comment, so I need to ask your forgiveness on something. When I was talking about changing our community prayer time from Friday to Thursday, it made it sound like you guys think it was an issue. I know that's not true. Y'all want me to be with my wife. And second of all, it may have sounded like that Rhonda was the only one who wanted this day. That's not true either. We both want to have that. Sometimes extroverted pastors open their mouths when they shouldn't, and I am sorry about that, so forgive me. You guys are wonderful, and you've always encouraged me to take care of myself and my family, so I want everyone to say I'm sorry and ask for your forgiveness. So we come during this time of prayer and concerns and gatherings, and I want to open up the floor for people who have things in their heart this morning. Yes, Betty.
Neighbor that has been on the one, he passed away yesterday about noon. And, but I really appreciate everybody praying.
And Betty, what was her name again?
It was a he. It was Gilbert Ryan.
So we want to, Betty must, that Gilbert Ryan passed away, died this week. So we want to first just offer prayers for them, the family. Lord, hear our prayers. And Betty just wants to voice thanksgiving for us who've been praying for this family. So thank you, God. And Lord, hear our praises. Others. I know that we continue as a church to remember both Janice here this morning and Nancy as we are, they're grieving the loss of their husbands and we're grieving the loss of our friends and family. We've also had the loss of Marilyn and Roger and his family. I had a chance to be part of that funeral and this week, and it just was a celebration of the beauty of Marilyn. You learn just how wonderful a person is when they share the stories. And so, but we want to remember all these and our church as we walk through these days of grief. Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, Marianne.
Daily prayer for peace for Donna Brown and Rich Clausen.
Yes, we want to continue to remember our brother Rich Clausen and Donna as they are continually taking treatments and fighting this cancer with the best of technology and the prayers that we offer. So Lord, hear our prayers.
I hate to keep buttoning.
It's okay, Betty.
But I noticed in the paper when I got home yesterday that Dawson Warrington, that passed away, they're having his memorial at noon today at the Life Church in Buckingham.
And that's Dawson
Warrington.
They're having his.
Been praying for him too.
Been praying for him, and his memorial service is this afternoon.
At noon.
I do apologize, Betty. It's hard for me to hear Mass. So let's remember the family and the community. This person, Lord, hear our prayers. I want to continue to thank you all for your faithfulness and giving of your resources and time and money and just all that and maintaining. I just am so thankful when I look at how many people gather here in our sanctuary. Come on Facebook Live and check it out on YouTube, and you know we're hanging in there. And I am so thankful for you guys and your sacrifices and your dedication. That just means a lot to me, and I just appreciate it. And so, Lord, hear our praises. Yes, Ryan.
John Paul says, thanks for the prayers for Pam surgery this past Wednesday. It went well.
Okay, so John Paul wants to celebrate the surgery for Pam, his wife. It went well. And for you who don't know, John is our organist person extraordinaire. Sometimes he's played here, played piano, and his wife has gone through surgery. So, Lord, hear our prayers. Let's continue to remember ourselves as Americans in this season of election, and with the Supreme Court Justice being nominated, our country is very much torn. And my prayer is that we who follow Jesus will continue to remember that the fruit of the Spirit is not optional, no matter who you vote for. So we're still called to be people of love, joy, peace, and patience, and kindness, and goodness, and self-control. And may we be that light as we're making decisions about who we feel God should put in charge. So Lord, hear our prayers. I want to hear something you're thankful for today. Tell me a couple of thanksgivings, somebody. Yes, Marianne.
I am so thankful that I still have enough flowers to bring to the altar.
So Marianne says she is so thankful she has plenty of flowers still to bring to the altar. And they're really, I love the purplish stuff. Oh, yes. I know Paula Moore out there loves that stuff too, the purplish colors. Lord, hear our praises.
And we're thankful for Marianne doing that.
And Betty says they're thankful for Marianne doing that, and I am too. Lord, hear our prayers. And I'm also thankful for something else. Lily has been bringing her stuffed friends in here, and she's actually brought more in here. So like when we eventually move a lot of these stuffed animals out, we're going to disperse them to other children. And she's willing to do that. She's given some, is that right? Yep. But she's been filling up our pews with just a lot of fun friends. And I hope it's added a sense of fun and excitement. We've got the Mr. Rogers thing going in here, but hey, he's my hero. I'm the pastor. We'll go with it, okay? But Lord, hear our praises. One other Thanksgiving other than me. Yes, Amelia? Amelia says she is thankful for church. Oh, that's great that young people are still thankful for church. Lord, hear our praises. So let's on that go to prayer this morning. Lord Jesus, as Amelia declared, we are thankful for this thing called church. At times we are imperfect. Pastors open up their mouths when they shouldn't. We stumble over things we shouldn't. Sometimes we react out of meanness. But we thank you, Jesus, that you formed us, your body. And that we read in the book of Acts that you put your spirit into us to be your light to the world. Forgive us, Father, when we don't live up to your teachings. Forgive us when, instead of loving our enemies, we hate them or curse them. Or forgive us, Lord, when we close our hearts to those who are of a different economic or racial color than we are. Forgive us, God, when we do not love our spouses the way you would desire, or our children, or our parents. Forgive us, God, when we allow the fear and anxiety of life to pull us away from you instead of pulling us to you. And so we come acknowledging our sins and receiving the forgiveness of the blood of Christ. We thank you, Jesus, for your death and resurrection and ascension and your promise to us that one day we who follow you will have new bodies. That we will live in a new creation where there is no more war or poverty or people hurting one another. Lord, hear the prayer and praises of your people this day. There's so many. And there's many out in internet land and here who haven't voiced them. Concerns and hurts and thanksgivings. And those moments of quiet, your Holy Spirit is so loud. Your Spirit tells us that we're loved, forgiven, and that when we fall down, there's a hand to help us back up. So in the midst of all the yelling and screaming in America, or politics and racial strife, may we hear that voice. And as we hear that voice, may it send us out into our world to be peacemakers, to be promoters of peace and justice, to reach across the aisles, Holy Spirit, to those who are different than us, who think differently than us, to love as you did, Jesus. May we be willing to take risks for your kingdom, trusting that no matter what happens to us, we'll be okay because you defeated death. And so, Jesus, we gather as the disciples of old to pray that prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And this morning, I just want to acknowledge, I appreciate the leadership of Robin. She has to put up with sometimes my crazy themes, and it's hard sometimes to match hymns to that. And she sent a text that says, you know, we need to sing today, they'll know that we're Christians by our love. And I think we've been singing that a lot, but I think we need to declare that in the midst of all that we're going through. So, Robin, take it over.
So you'll all have the words up here, and I actually invite you to stay seated, and we'll sing all the verses to it, and just enjoy the words. I'm actually going to sit down too, and we can just pretend we're at the campfire and singing together and kind of invoke that love.
So children, those in internet led and those here, you're welcome to shout it out, but you don't have to if you just want to quietly shout it. But imagine someone walked up here today and they were real short and they had a lot of muscles and they had long hair and it was brown, and they said to you, "Hello everybody, I'm Pastor Rodney." Would you believe them?
No.
Would you believe them? No.
No.
They don't look like Pastor Rodney, do they? Or let's imagine today I walked up and I was standing here and I started yelling out mean things at everybody. And I started calling children bad names and yelling at Mary Ellen and just saying yucky stuff. Would you wonder if that's Pastor Rodney or something?
Yeah.
Or Pastor Rodney's having a bad day? Or do you think maybe aliens had kidnapped Pastor Rodney and put a new different here? See, you know people by how they look, don't you? You get used to it. You know, I'm getting to learn how Amelia looks. She has red hair, reddish hair. Where's that red? I don't know what it, I know what she looks like though. And I know how people look by. And then I also know that if Marion brought flowers in today and all of a sudden she started ripping up the flowers, I'd know that something's not right there, wouldn't you? Or she said, I don't like horses. I'm like, is that Marion? You know, Jesus tells something to his disciples. I want you to hear this. In the book of John, he says to his disciples, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I loved you, you also should love one another. By this is Jesus talking, everyone will know that you're my disciples, if you have love for one another. Hey children, did we just sing something about a song about that? Yeah, didn't we? That how we treat people tells us who we are. That if we don't treat people as Jesus treats them, would people think that we really are his disciples then? Ooh, that's a hard one. Because we know people from what they look like, don't we? And Jesus says that they're going to know we're disciples of Jesus and how we love our own people, our own followers, and everyone outside the church. How we treat people who are different than us. How we love one another. So if someone walked up and said, I'm Rodney, and they're very short with long hair and they got dark hair, who's got a lot of muscles, you'd be like, I don't know if that's Pastor Rodney. But the hard thing, children, is that when we're mean to people, people who don't love Jesus and follow Jesus may think, wow, are they Jesus people? That's kind of tough, isn't it, to hear that? Because Jesus really wants us to love. So children, guess what? He really wants you to love your parents, even when you're mad at them. Because I know sometimes you get mad at them, don't you? When they say, I want you to do this. He wants you to love your parents, your grandparents. He wants you to love your brother or sister when they take that toy. And you're mad at them. But guess what, adults? We're not off the hook either. He wants you to love, if you're a Republican, that Democrat the way Jesus would. And if you're a Republican, he wants you to love that Democrat the way Jesus would. Because that's how the world will know we're followers of Jesus. So what do you think about that, children? It's hard, but it's good. Wouldn't you say that? So we don't get confused that someone says they're Pastor Rodney and they're not Pastor Rodney. But you know what? Jesus will help us love people even when it's hard. And the way I do it is I say, Jesus, help me. So why don't y'all repeat after me today this prayer? Jesus,
Jesus,
we know you want us to love people.
We know you want us to love people.
Sometimes that's hard.
Sometimes that's hard.
So help us out here.
So help us out here.
To love people.
To love people.
As you do.
As you do.
In your name.
Will you please stand and join me in our offertory hymn? The words to this are probably new, but the tune is an old tune called The Ash Grove. So if you know that old folk tune, you'll know this one.
Thank you.
God highest, in heaven, Hosanna and praise. And we thank you so much for the blessings of life you provide, from a cup of cold water, to health insurance, to the financial resources you give. So thank you so much, God, for those who share. Take these resources, bless them, expand them, and use them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, a good book, a good piece of literature, always has that first sentence that catches your attention. Sometimes a good first sentence will actually give you an appetizer for what's about to come. Give me some examples. In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. From The Hobbit. And it brings up a lot of questions. Is a hobbit, and why are they in the ground? Or see Dick run. How many know that one? Yeah. Or Ralph Ellison, I am an invisible man. About the life struggles of a black man in America. Here's one. Scarlett O'Hara was not beautiful, but men seldom realized it when caught by her charm. Gone with the Wind. Or what about this one? It was a bright, cold day in April, and the clocks were striking 13. Kind of felt like that in April, didn't it? From that sci-fi classic, 1984. All children, except one, grow up. Peter Pan. Call me Ishmael, Moby Dick. It's a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. Pride and Prejudice. Or Toni Morrison, 124 was spiteful from her book, Beloved. Here's one. Mr. and Mrs. Dursley of number 4 Privet Drive was proud to say that they were perfectly normal. Thank you very much. And then we come to find out they weren't very normal. In the light of the moon, a little egg lay on a leaf. The very hungry caterpillar. And then my favorite, one of my favorite sci-fi classics. In a beginning is the time for taking the most delicate care that the balances are correct. From that classic Dune. There's something about that first sentence. It grabs you. And then if you read the rest of the book, you realize, that first sentence was very important. And so we open up the Bible. And all those who translated the Hebrew decided this would, and they put a little period here and said this will be the first sentence. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Oh, there's a lot of stuff packed in that first verse, my friends. And many of you are, please don't, Rodney, don't unpack it today. I won't. But all kinds of questions. Why? When did the beginning begin? And what is this heaven and earth? And why was the earth formless and void like a bunch of water? And this wind sweeping over the face of the deep, what was that? And we're drawn into this story of God's working in creation. See, that first sentence is important. And in that first sentence, we hear this little word called heavens. Everybody say heavens.
Heavens.
Sometimes we say heaven, and sometimes we say heavens. It's pretty interchangeable in Scripture. We're going to talk about heaven for the next few Sundays. Y'all ready? We're going to talk about heaven. Now, I want to give you a little disclaimer. You ready? Actually, talking about heaven is a lot harder than you think it is. We think we've got it all figured out. Then you start reading in Scripture, you realize, oh my gosh, I thought I didn't know that. And so I want to invite everyone, as we're going through this, if you have questions, comments, challenges, email me. We'll expand on it. I'll try to look at different, and we're going to look at heaven from different angles. And I'm going to give you my best reading on it. And I'm going to try to share the things I see in Scripture, but I'm also going to share with you things I don't see and what I think modern popular culture gets wrong about heaven, at least from a biblical perspective. You may have noticed this week I sent an email out, I think yesterday, and I posted on Facebook for y'all to watch a video out of the Bible Project about heaven and earth. I invite you to do that. The Bible Project, I've been encouraging people in our church to learn, and a lot of them would tell you, once they've been watching those videos, that they have actually fallen in love with Scripture more. It's helped them understand the big picture. Isn't that right, Kathy? Kathy said I could call upon her, but don't ask her to speak. But she would say. In fact, one member in our church said as she was watching these Bible Project videos that Scripture made more sense to her. Because see, once you know the big picture, things make much sense. And so we're going to talk about heaven. And so one of the questions that we're going to be looking at is all the questions about heaven. Where is heaven and how we get there and all that good stuff. But as we talk about heaven, I want to put it in the context of what we've already talked about because it's interconnected. Because we have a destination, and Revelation 21 tells us that there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, and that God is making all things new. And that what that new thing looks like and how it gets there is a little complicated. We don't know if it's going to come about as some kind of birth out of the old or a use of fire or either literally, but all we know is something new, a new heaven and earth is coming. And we've discovered, haven't we, that the bodily resurrection of Jesus is God's declaration that the new has begun because Jesus is alive. And you'll notice that in this thing about heaven. Well, if there's a new heaven, there must be an old heaven. Wouldn't you say that? New Coke means there was usually an old Coke, okay? And that's how it goes. And so one of the questions that we want to deal with too quickly today is ask the question, where is heaven? Everybody ask me the question. One, two, three.
Where is heaven?
That's a great question. I'm glad you asked. But most of us, when we hear that question, our tendency, this is what we like to do with our bodies. Where's heaven? Come on, I mean, that's what we do. When we pray, we raise our hands up. We stand up. And in the New Testament and the Old, there's all this language about upward. So there's constant reality that heaven is up somewhere. And that's what we feel. It's got to be up there. It's, you know, kind of right there. But it's up. And that's the language that we see throughout Scripture. That where heaven is, it's up. Where does that come from? Why is that there? What is Scripture trying to tell us when it declares that the heaven or heavens is up? Now, here's this interesting little story that kind of illustrates this idea about heaven being up. It's in Genesis 28, and it's about Jacob. Now, Jacob had just messed up everything. He not only opened his mouth, he intentionally stole from Esau some stuff, his birthright, because he was Jacob. And he was on the run. He was like, I really goofed here. So he was trying to escape his life, because Esau was really mad. And the story that Jacob left Beersheba, went toward Haran, and he came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set on the earth, and the top of it was reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land in which you lie, I'll give to you and your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and your offspring. Know that I am with you. Everybody hear that? Know that I am with you, and you will keep you wherever you go, and will bring back to you this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, whoa, surely the Lord is in this place. I did not know it. And he was afraid, and he said in that wonderful 80s word, how awesome is this place? There is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. All apologies to Robert Plant, who's trying to buy the stairway to heaven for that lady. Did you get it? You didn't get it. Okay. That's where the gate of heaven was, okay? It's not steps, it's a ladder. Well, that's an understanding that they had. Because heaven was up, and they were down, and he was saying, boy, the gate of heaven is right here. And he was amazed. Well, in the ancient world, of the world of Scripture, the Hebrews were much no different than the rest of their society. They understood earth and heaven kind of like this figure that I've given you, this picture. And when you open up Scripture for the first verse of Genesis, and then you read it, and then you look at Scripture from Genesis, Exodus, heaven and earth kind of look like this. First of all, they believed that earth was flat. And it was floating on water. Because when you open up the first couple of chapters of Genesis, what is God doing? He's coming to the water. He's separating it. He's putting a kind of a dome. And the water up high is put on top of that dome. And then the land is flat on top of it. So they believe the earth was, the land was floating on water. If you just take the story literally, it's just what it is. And they believed that right beyond that water was the heavens, the gate to the heavens. And so there was this thing called the gate of heaven. We just read about Jacob and that ladder, okay? That's how they saw it. And it's pretty obvious, guys. Go outside right now. Trust me, go outside and stand on your ground. Stand on the ground. The earth is flat, isn't it? You're like, no, it's not. Yes, it is. Just look, it's flat. And on top of that, Mary, hear this. There's a dome in the sky. And on a clear day, you can see the blue dome, can't you? And why is it blue? Because it's holding back the water. Because where does rain come from? Sky. That's how the ancients saw it. Now, they weren't into the scientific method. They were making observations. And their observations told them, the earth is flat, it's floating on water, and heaven is just beyond that blue dome. Now, there's still a few people in the world who believe the earth is flat. Now, some of you are saying, well, wait a minute, Pastor Rodney, where are you going here? I thought we were talking about where heaven is. We are. Because toward the ancients, heaven is right there. You go up from the earth, you can build your Tower of Babel to it, get into heaven, and there's the heavens. It's right there. So all we got to do is just go up into the sky, and we'll be in heaven. Really? Well, here's the problem. We know the earth is round. We also know that we've sent rockets up into the sky and there's no heaven up there. And we've sent rockets to Mars, and I think one of our Voyager or whatever has kind of gone beyond the solar system now, and they still haven't discovered heaven yet. So were the biblical authors wrong? Well, the problem we have, my friends, is that we who are light, rational people, there's a tendency that we who are more rational and wise, that has done a lot of good in our society. It's opened up and freed us from some superstition. But it has a tendency sometimes to make us arrogant. To make us think that all those people back then, they don't know what they're talking about. They don't have nothing to teach us. Because after all, they believed the earth was flat and it was dome, and we've been there and we know this now. But I want to show you something. To answer this question, where is heaven? Because one of the roles of scholars who translate the Hebrew and Greek language is that for them to be a good Bible translator, they got to become fully aware of the language and history of the time. Because there are a couple, like prime example, if they translate a Hebrew word as the only Hebrew word in the whole Bible, they've got to go outside the Bible to see how that word is used so that they can make a proper translation, so they can give to us the correct word of God. But they also have to translate the culture of that time to us. And so then us preachers and teachers have to say, okay, we live in 2020. What is the ancients telling us about where heaven is? Because I could just dismiss all this and say, well, that's all back then and we don't listen to it. But that's the problem. Because we could lose the gold nuggets when we do that. So we need to translate, and I'm going to show you why. And there's this wonderful little story in the book of Joshua, because we're answering the question, where is heaven, and we're going to get there. In the book of Joshua, there's this fun little story. And in that story, Joshua is in the promised land, and they're having all those bloody battles, and I don't have time to go with what all that means, okay? That's a whole different series of sermons. But they're having these bloody battles, and Joshua's like, I want to defeat this enemy. And I want to be done today. I don't have time to move it into him tomorrow. Let's get the task done today. But he realizes that the sun is setting. And it's going to become dark. And every army officer knows you cannot fight in the dark in the old times. So he says, you know, I got an idea. I'm going to ask God to extend the day. And that way it'll give me plenty of light to get the job done. So in this story, he basically asks God, sun, stand still at Gibeon and moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stopped. Now, can you imagine if, this is funny, really, I think this is funny. If Joshua came to God and said, God, I need you to make the sun stand still so the day can go longer. God says, Josh, I need to tell you something. That's not going to make the day go longer. And Josh would be like, why? Because the sun is already standing still. What? The sun doesn't go around the earth. What? Now, what you would need to ask me is, okay, God, would you make the earth stop on his axis? That way the sun just stays where it is. But that would have confused Joshua. He would not understand what God's talking about. Why? Humanity had not discovered that yet. See, God has no problem with humans learning stuff. Did you know that? And the Bible is not designed to be a science book. But it is designed to answer questions that are important to us. But it's the questions Scripture answers, not the questions we always ask. Did you hear what I said? We come to Scripture not to bring our questions, but to go to Scripture to discover the questions Scripture is asking and then hearing the answers that it gives. Now, we can bring questions to it, but some of our questions Scripture doesn't answer, like, who should I go out with on Friday night? It doesn't tell us that. But it does tell us one's behavior you should be, kind of behavior you should have with the one you go out on Friday night. See what I'm saying? So, God did not bring to these ancient people a scientific understanding that they had not attained yet. Everybody's tracking with me? That doesn't make scripture wrong. It just means that God is loving to speak to the language of his people. Parents, if your child asks you a question about what time it is, let's say you're a four-year-old child, says, what time is it, Mom? Let's say Robin begins to answer that question by talking about the theory of relativity and time. I mean, I'm serious. Or if the kids ask you about the birds and the bees, and you start telling them other stuff, and all they want to know is about the bird and the bee that's roaming around. God is God works with the children of what they know and don't know. God's not going to confuse us. We need to grow up and learn. Well, guess what? We've learned a few things about the world, haven't we? Does that mean that there is no heaven? No. There is a heaven. And what we have to do is then translate where heaven is and take what's the truth of Scripture and translate it to our world. Okay? And a lot of times we theologians don't do a good job at that. Because either we make it so literal that it doesn't speak to the modern mind, or we dismiss all the ancient stuff and look down upon it, and we don't learn anything. And so sometimes it takes storytellers and poets and novelists to tell us things. So, you know, in history, sometimes you get blessed and you have both a theologian and a storyteller, like C.S. Lewis. He was an atheist at one time. And then in his autobiography, he was surprised by joy. Jesus got a hold of him. And he began to write all these wonderful theological works like Mere Christianity and a lot of good stuff that still affects us scholars and teachers today. But he also told stories. And the favorite one is The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. How many have read that one? Or saw a book or movie? Well, in that story is a story about four children during World War II in England, okay? And they go to live with their uncle, yeah. And there's this big old house that they have. And one day, one of the children by the name of Lucy is in this house. And she walks into this room, and she sees this big old wardrobe closet. She's like, whoa. And like any good child, they're going to explore that big wardrobe closet. So she goes into that wardrobe closet, and she's walking through the coats and the hangers, and she's walking, and all of a sudden, she begins to feel branches, and she's stepping on snow. And she looks back, and there's this closet, but she's stepping on snow. And she's like, this is strange. So in this, and I like this little passage, it says, Lucy felt a little frightened. That's how it is when we sometimes approach the supernatural. But she felt inquisitive and excited as well. She looked back over her shoulder, and there between the dark tree trunks, she could still see the open doorway of the wardrobe and even catch a glimpse of the empty room from which she had stepped out. She had, of course, left the door open, for she knew that it's a very silly thing to shut oneself into a wardrobe. I like that. It seemed to still be daylight there. I can always get back if anything goes wrong, thought Lucy. And in this story, she steps through this wardrobe on Earth, but she comes into a different place. And in this place called Narnia, there's animals that talk, creatures she's never encountered, and there's this lion called Aslan. Oh, what a great lion. It's a place that's near her, but it's not like Earth, but it's near her. See, heaven is not somewhere we go to, but it is a place. You can't get there by a rocket, but you can get there. And you may not be able to see it, but it really is all around us. It's kind of like a different dimension to us modern world people. But even that doesn't make sense. And it has its own world, but it's different than us. And it kind of parallels with us, but it's also different. In this passage from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 16, it says this. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. This is talking about Jesus. For in him, that's Christ, all things in heaven and on earth were created. Things visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. For me, a better way of talking about heaven, maybe for us modern folk, is that it's the unseen realm. It's the visible place. Everybody say visible place. Unvisible, excuse me. I started over. It's the invisible place. Thank you. So in other words, it's the place that we can't get to from here. We still can get to if God allows it. It's kind of like walking into a wardrobe closet and coming out at another place that has its own time and place and creatures, but it's also connected to earth. And in the beginning of chapter 1 of Genesis, it said, in the beginning, God created the heavens. Now, as we come to an end, imagine if all of a sudden I'm walking along and I say, hey guys, I'm going into heaven. And I disappear. Now you think I would just disappear. No, I didn't disappear. I just stepped into heaven. And then imagine all of a sudden I come back on the, over there and I walk down the aisle. Hey guys, I'm back from heaven. Something like that. It's a place. And the reason we can't see it anymore is because we've been kicked out of the garden. Our sin and evil and our decisions that we were going to be like the gods. And there's only one God that gets to rule heaven, and that's God, not us. And so heaven is the invisible place. It's the unseen realm. We cannot access it from here unless we have permission. So in other words, don't try to get in there if God didn't give you permission. Because that can create all kinds of problems. Because in this unseen place, there's a lot of stuff there that doesn't make any sense. And there's things in there that are not good for us either. Because the unseen realm can also be dangerous. And Scripture talks about it every once in a while. Now for us modern people, this sounds kind of silly maybe. But if you believe in the God, there are many that think the belief in God is silly. So I take the ancient's word on it and try to translate it into our understanding that there's a heaven. And sometimes, guys, that heaven breaks in on us and it's both beautiful and sometimes so terrifying. And we're going to talk about that. And that one day we believe that that heaven, as our earth, will be renewed. And one day that heaven and earth will be back on earth again. But until then, we've got to spend a little time wondering about heaven through Scripture, what it means for us today. So brothers, where's heaven? Not really exactly sure. But what I do know, from the best reading I can of the news, it's the invisible place, it's the unseen realm. We cannot access it from here unless we have permission. Okay? Have any questions? Send them to me as we begin this. As we stand and sing our wonderful little praise song today.
So y'all know the drill, right? I'll kick us off and you'll follow.
This is the day.
We will rejoice
and be glad in it.
And be glad.
So this is the day the Lord has made, both earth and heaven. So my brothers and sisters, now go out and be the light of Christ in our world, celebrating what God has created on the earth that we can see and the mysteries of heaven that we cannot. So now go in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.